Well, I'm truly, in terms of my work, a creature of the times I live in, the culture I live in, the politics I live in, a child of the Depression, a child of rising anti-Semitism in Europe and fervent anti-Semitism in the United States at the same time, where first generation Jewish boys, through it all, wanting not really to be Jewish so much as to be like them, the very people who didn't like them, you know, wanting to be big and blonde and muscular, and out of that the Superman fantasy came, you know, written by two nerdy Jewish boys. Wanting to assimilate, wanting to be part of that game and part of that show, and the American comic strip was very much culturally a big deal and part of that show in the 1930s and 1940s, and of course that was what I was passionate about and wanted to throw myself into. This was a form at the time that a lot of young Jewish kids fell in love with and saw as their way into the deal, into the American collective, where you would go from nowhere, from rags to riches, and be celebrated and be loved and make a lot of money. And more important, and most importantly for young nerdy Jewish boys, meet girls who would otherwise never look at you. I don't think comics any longer, the newspaper comic strip barely exists anymore. And God knows that 82 going in 83, I can hardly speak for a younger generation, but it's the, if comics at all have a reality for any young people, it's the alternative comics that come out in as graphic novels in some cases, and which expands the imagination and expands the use of the confessional sometimes to sorry extent, and other times quite beautifully. But it's a whole different form. But it's no way any longer to from rags to riches, because nobody makes money at, you know, the amount of work put into these graphic novels. And I'm working on one right now. It takes forever to get it all done, and the financial results are, you know, barely enough to keep you above the poverty level. But it's still a work of love, and that's what these people are in it for.